And the specificity of the system. Right? You could achieve specificity by building a lot of profiling steps and making sure that you're going to check and rely on a lot of phosphorylation with the receptors to build the specificity. But then you are going to be very slow, and maybe you're going to lose your signal as you go along. And vice versa, if you try to make a system which is very fast, you tend to lose in specificity. Okay? So, yes?
When this is actually happening in the body, you have a T cell in your receptors, and they're moving relative to each other?
Yeah, so typically, right. So typically what's going on, again, is that T cells picked up the infection wherever your bugs are breaking in your lungs, in your mucosas, and your skins. And they are going to move to lymph nodes to present this peptide. And then there you have kind of a treadmill of T cells which are constantly scanning, right? You know, if people do intravital microscopy inside a live animal. And what you see that these cells are moving in not a completely random manner. They kind of have some track associated with some matrix inside the tissue. And what they are doing is that they are passing by these dynamic cells, and it's really like a treadmill, right? So they are going to scan this surface and the typical time in the order of 1 minute. The question I had yesterday that addressed that. But you just have 1 minute to do that because you want to make sure that the next T cell which comes by has a chance to sense this peptide. This is the minute to make the decision. If you do get activated, if you do detect something which is very like non-self, then you're going to do something else. You know, you're going to get activation, and this activation is going to boost adhesion in particular. It's going to make these T cells get stuck to the dendritic cells, and then you can make longer decisions. But very importantly, you want to limit this time because you want to make sure that the 100 million T cells, the 100 million different clones that you have in your cells, and in your organism, have a chance to probe these dendritic cells and see if there is something foreign. So yes, you are very limited in time, and you are doing this kind of continuous motion. Any other questions? Or? Okay. So let's move on. So again, kinetic profiling, the idea is that at some level, we're not going to invent any kind of fancy physics or fancy chemistry. We're going to start with something which is simple, biochemistry. You take your ligand, you take your receptors, you should be able to form a complex. And just based on this interaction, so again, there is an on rate, which is pretty universal, and there is an off rate related to this lifetime, which depends on the quality of the peptide. Now, when people started to think about this a bit more quantitatively, one readout for activation was when you look at the T cells, they form something which is called an immunological synapse. So practically, when you look at the surface of these cells, and you look at the way these receptors get organized, there's a very nice pattern which occurs very quickly, which is like, you start at short time point, before activation, you're going to see the dendritic cells with the peptide NHC being completely kind of random. And again, the T cells coming on the surface and maybe not interacting with them. I'm sure you have so many colors for your notes, I'm sorry. But at the same time, this of course, you don't have just peptide-NHC on the surface of the cells. What you have on top of that, you have some ligands called ICAM, which are kind of integrin or adhesion molecules, and LFA. I mean, there's a lot of jargon. You don't have to care about exactly the name of these things, but you have some adhesion proteins which are interspersed everywhere. And what's very striking is that when you look at the size of these interactions, this is rather large, maybe on the order of 40 nanometers. When you look at the whole extracellular domain, the way they interact, but when you do the same measurement on a peptide NHC PCR interaction, this is much smaller, on the order of 20 nanometers. So one idea which came about to be able to achieve this kind of purifying device to be able to solve this problem was that maybe you are going to get some kind of self-organization which is going to organize the interactions between the dendritic cells and the synapse in this way. You're going to get the dendritic cells, so when you look at typically at later time scales, what you're going to get is that the T cell is going to self-organize, whereby the receptors are are going to form a kind of plug in the center. We will peptide HC in front of it. And again, this is on the scale of 20 nanometers. When you look at the adhesion molecules, they are going to form a kind of ring on the side. Obviously, you know, you have a symmetric rotational symmetry of the spin. So you're going to do this adhesion, and you're going to build some kind of adhesion ring around in such a way that you're going to kind of focus the interactions into a corner. So this is kind of a very appealing idea, because in a sense, what you're going to do is you're going to couple the bulk chemistry that you have at the level of this interaction with some mechanical force, which in a way is going to phase separate between adhesion molecules and ligand receptors, and maybe you could get something which gets very good at discriminating between different time scales for this upgrade. So this was the model which was proposed by Thomas Voss now, Michel Corbotti. Again, it's a nice model if you like about Michel Corbotti. I think it was in 2001. And I'm going to go a little bit through it and show some predictions and then show shortcomings to move to the next part, which takes a longer time. But it's a very cute idea because, in a sense, you're going to rely on self-organization of these receptors based on the way of some mechanical constraints. You cannot squeeze, it's very hard for these ligands to reach these ligands if it stays in proximity of very big molecules. And using this kind of phase separation, you might be able to build a system which kind of resonates based on this off rate and maybe make a very good decision to have self-concept information.
This is supposed to happen in the first minute.
Right, so that's a big problem in this system. So in fact, experimentally, I left it kind of in the bed, because experimentally, when you do these things, it takes more time. So this decision that we have here, in a way, is maybe a bit upstream. But I'm kind of following the most striking stuff is that when people measure activation and when you do microscopy, you see that. So it's very tempting to believe that this is what you are using to make the discrimination. So that's one problem that we have.
And so there's no self, non-self discrimination.
So what's the point? Is that you could think that depending on the strength of these interactions, right? Depending on the way you build the mechanics, maybe you're going to build the threshold to be able to do this phase segregation, and that's the idea of how it had in 2001. Right. So the way you do this math, and again, it's kind of a big model, but it's something that you can do because you can measure a lot of stuff in this system, is that if you start to parameterize the separation between these two membranes as a function of X, Y, T, so you use so everything in the plane of the membrane is going to be XY, and we deal with the separation mostly. You want to solve an equation whereby the separation between your two membranes, you are going to do some kind of a relaxation thing, which is going to be related to some free energy associated with the separation between the mechanical energy associated with bending the membrane, maybe forming this tight complex on the membrane. So this is the free energy I'm going to detail later. And then some noise term, which I can't detail, but to get the system going. And the way this free energy was written is that you're going to sum up all the interactions that you have, plus some mechanical deformation from the membrane. So the mechanical term from the membrane is the classical bending modulus plus I'm not sure I'm using the usual notation, but right. You're going to get one time of bending modulus and one time of surface tension integrated across the whole membrane. So this is just to deal with the deformation that you can get here. You want absolutely to put the bending modulus, because you could probably do exactly the flip phase where the big proteins are going to be in the center, the small proteins are going to be in the center. Then you see that you get two big deformations, and that's going to pay a price which is very high.
I think you've got to say instead of the X.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
It's somewhere.
Yeah, everything has to be square.
Isn't that correct?
And then what you do is that, of course, you're going to add, and that's something which was very inspiring from how it works, that you can like add the price that you pay for deforming this bone. It was very striking that people were starting to do these measurements where you take beam, classical measurement biophysics, you load them with a PET-MSC, you load them with a TCR, and then you start to measure the potential associated with deformation. You have one term associated with the TCR. So again, you integrate. This is going to be the number, the surface concentration of your TCR. When you form the bond between the two, you're going to pay a price. So you have a Gaussian term associated with the natural length of his bond. So this is on the order of 20 nanometers. Again, this is kind of a trivial thing, right? If you have a natural length, you're going to be the minimal of its potential. So you multiply it by the number of bonds that you have. That's going to be the gain in energy that you have. If you start to stretch your bond because this membrane is a bit more far apart, you're going to start to pay a price. And in fact, this is rather stiff, and you're going to pay a huge price. And you do the same for the adhesion protein. So two adhesion proteins interacting in this red scheme. Again, you're going to have a natural bond. So you integrate all these free energies, you can solve these things. And of course, what you want to do on top of that is to deal with the biochemistry. So if you start to look at the time dynamics of the number of complex that you are forming, so again, this is a function of x y t. One part is going to be the usual biochemistry, right? Exactly like the way we work it here. So 100 associated with the association of the PET-MSC with the TCR, one off rate associated with the dissociation, right? And then you add the term associated with the variation recoupling with the membrane. So, sorry, one term of diffusion inside the membrane. And then the coupling with mechanical force, and this I have to check the notes that I remember. Again, people from the membrane field, I think they are very familiar with this term. So this was quite new for a new paper. You can see that it looks like a very big model with a lot of parameters, but again, everything can be measured, right? I mean, this on rate, I told you that we can measure by surface plasmon resonance, diffusion constant that we typically measure with the. Yes, I'm counting the number of the complex, right?
The second line, is that by TCR and MHC?
Yes. In the original model, these are not very affected. No. We are just changing this multiple factor of 2, we are just dragging that. So I think the same number was in the effect. Right, so very strikingly, again, when you look at our model, is that it is a big model with a lot of parameters, it's a bit scary to handle, but at the same time, most of its parameters have been measured. So, yes, it looks very complicated and it's not a single equation model, but sometimes it might be okay to deal with this very big model to try to see if it goes in the right range. So again, this is measured by SPR, right? Typical biochemistry. This can be measured by microscopy. This binding modulus, there is a lot of people who have been doing this kind of mechanical measurements, and these numbers are fairly well known in the case of simple cells. Maybe the most difficult terms you would think in terms of measurement are this kind of bending of the potential associated with the stretching of the bone. And again, people have measured this stuff by using beads and forcing to form the bone and trying to stretch it. So there were some measurements associated with this thing. So practically, you have a parameter, the only parameter which was not known is maybe this coupling, this viscosity term, and you could use that maybe to look at the data. So forget about the parameter, I don't want to make too big a point, people need them to go up to the model and test your sensitivity. The most important is that it's a closed form, and then you can go and check what kind of features come across. Yes.
Could you go over what the last term on the bottom of the board is again? I'm
right. Sorry. So this is a stretching of a bone, right?
Okay.
So if your membrane does the right separation, if you have a natural length of the bone here, you have the minimum of the potential. As soon as you compress it, as soon as you stretch it, you're going to pay the price.
And what's the term above it then?
Same thing for the peptide and HTCR, right?
Oh.
So there's a natural length for this bone, for the peptide and HTCR, there's a natural length for this bone. And you see that because you are making them diffuse, right, you're going to start to come and you're making them, you know, get coupled to the free energy of the membrane.
Yeah.
You're going to be able to couple this, the price you pay if you don't locate them at the right place, if you leave them completely mixed, to the equilibrium that you get at the end.
I think maybe your question was related to whether there's a similar dynamic equation to the adhesion. So as well as
absolutely, the, right, that's right. Yeah. You write the same equation for the free peptide MC, you write the same for the free adhesion molecule, you write the same for the complex adhesion molecule.
Is there no coupling between the pi TCR and the pi? I mean,
you mean coupling in terms of interactions?
Yeah.
So these are the 2D concentration of this complex, and they don't interact a priori, right? If you look at the binding affinities of these molecules, they are completely different things. They don't interact with each other. The only coupling that you have is through this membrane. This
so how does that segregation take place?
Right, so through mechanical coupling. What you're going to do is that you're going to try to minimize your free energy in such a way that at the end, the big molecules are going to be in one location, the small molecules are going to be in one location. You're not going to try to accommodate, right? You could think that if you extend that regime, you would go in a regime where maybe the membrane would accommodate, you know, we do something like that. And you see that there is a big price to pay for bending the membrane there, right? So what you are doing is that you are maybe trying to stretch the bone to accommodate, to try to flatten up the membrane, and mostly you're going to try to drive and move these molecules in such a way that the big molecules go into one place and the small molecules go into another place. Right? So, right, so again, no, like Matthew mentioned, you have to do the same for the adhesion molecule, you have to do the same, et cetera, so please go back to the paper and you can discuss further if you are interested in this kind of model. So you can implement it into in silico, and what's very striking is that, of course, no, you can reproduce this pattern. When you look at the equation, it's kind of very obvious. There is some features, I mean, you see a lot of models in immunology where what you put in is what you get. You know, there are so many parameters that you don't learn much, and you have to be very careful with that. What's very nice about this model is that it made some very precise predictions that people could go back and test. So in particular, when they plotted what you get in terms of for different k-on and k-off. So at that time, it was not clear that the k-on was fairly constant, or whatever. So again, classical equilibrium constant, we expect that there is maybe one kd, which enables you to get activation. And what our group found is that there is kind of two zones. If you look at the capacity of this cell to get activated, essentially, you're going to get a very narrow window of K-on and K-off, which enables you to get activation. So again, if K-off is small enough, meaning that the toe-off is large enough, like that, you get into a regime, and somehow there's a correlation with K-on that seems that maybe, you know, we need only one value of K-on. So if the K-off is right, you're going to be able to kind of, you know, resonate between all the bending, all the dynamics of the deformation of the membrane and the formation and deformation of the bones. But what's very striking in this model is predict another zone. So a simple equilibrium constant would have tell you that essentially with that half a plane, you just need to form the bone to be able to activate the cell. What they found is that these are more like narrow window of time, and there is kind of a zone here which is negative. And it's kind of very hard to understand qualitatively, but what you see is that if you are in the exact regime where K-on and K-off are kind of very identical, it's going to be very messed up, it's kind of going to resonate with the move of the adhesion molecules, and you're not going to be able to segregate very efficiently these proteins.
What do you mean by activation in the model?
So here activation is going to be, in fact, the readout, what this microscopy readout. Am I able to form this synapse? Am I able to separate?
Is that a reasonable definition of
no.
activity?
No. Again, because this is a very downstream readout, but in a way, at some level, that was one readout they wanted to fit.
Yeah.
It's completely reasonable because at that time, that was the most macroscopic observation that they could make in terms of activation. And again, you know, then you could write, you could look at the quality of forming the synapse and correlating it with the secretion of cytokines or proliferation downstream. And there was some bad correlation which told you that maybe it was a good proxy for activation. Yes, so the readout is, am I able to make this kind of rule-like? So if I look at these things from the top, what I get again is that I'm going to get a ring of adhesion molecules like that, and I'm going to get a small patch, the rule-like pattern where all the beta-NHCCR interactions are happening in the center. So that was kind of the readout. Am I able to recapitulate this pattern? Right, so what was very striking in that example, like again, it was a bit again against this dogma where TOF only matters, was that if you go to very high chaos, you can shrink the chaon, which doesn't seem to happen in the real system, but there might be a zone where having a very poor chaon and a very poor chaos, as long as you achieve the same KD, you might be able to still phase separate these two proteins, and you're still going to be able to achieve this Bulai pattern. Turns out that this was observed in some, this paper again was presented in 2001, and there were few papers following up on that stuff where they did find that there is indeed this zone for certain types of T cells. Now, I'm not going to go into much detail, but if you really poorly activate them, if you start to make mutation in such a way that the chaon is much weaker, indeed you are able to do this phase separation. So this is one example of a big model, right? Again, lots of parameters. Lots of physicists would look at that and say, well, this is way too ugly, I don't want to deal with that, but that's maybe the reality of what we're dealing with. We can measure these things, so maybe it's not so bad. But again, the point is that once you recapitulate a non-trivial feature, the idea that you can phase separate your receptors, you get this quantitative effect where you get maybe a cutoff in terms of TOF. There is this new window, there is this new zone in the phase space of parameter, which is a bit surprising, whereby if you have very weak interactions, you are still going to be able to separate under the condition that you change the chaon, which is not something that people have thought about in their experiments at first. So this is kind of a cautionary tale for the field. Beautiful model, right? And I think the physics is pretty well grounded. Lots of parameters are very well known. Nice observation in terms of dynamics. Some very good predictions that people went by and tested and were confirmed. But of course, there are always some caveats in some models. And the biggest caveat, which is something that Pierre kind of mentioned, is that the time scale doesn't quite comply to this idea that we can do this table within 1 minute. Right? It takes so much time, just because of the diffusion constant that you have in your terms here, and just because of the kind of relaxation time scale that you have in your free energy. If I remember well, it takes practically 1 hour to be able to achieve this pattern. So there is kind of a big quantitative problem there, which is that it doesn't seem to match, and maybe there are two constraints by these parameters, maybe these parameters were not properly measured, but at least at the time when the model was published, this was a bit of a caveat, which is that you had to wait a long amount of time before getting this phase separation, and for being able to achieve this ability to distinguish between these two peptides. And on top of that, when I first spoke to Arup, it seems that if you do the same model with a really large quantity of four ligands, this was done with a 1D1 quantity of ligands, and it gave you this kind of a plot. If you start to challenge the system with a huge quantity of four ligands, you are still able to achieve this kind of a pattern. So, right, I mean, cautionary tale, it's kind of a nice phenomenon. It might be worth revisiting if you want to understand T-cell biology on a long-term scale, but maybe it's not really solving our problems of self concept. Okay. Yes.
So, despite those two pairings that you mentioned, does the parameter space description of where chaons and chaos activations?
It looks reasonable. Yeah.
Okay.
It fell in the reasonable range. Again, typically, I think this time scale was on the order of 0.1. You have to go below 0.1 to be able to achieve the right segregation. When I say short topics, right, it's a big model, and so I think it's very nice and brings about the idea of coupling. And it's going to be revisited now in coming years to be able to deal with more phenotypes of T cells. But for the sake of discussion to move forward, I want to point out that things have to happen a bit faster. So we need to maybe more dynamic, less passive sorting of receptors and antigen molecules, and something maybe a bit more dynamic based on signaling to be able to make this kind of sharp decision.
And you can sort of do these things in vivo, right? So do you know already that this kind of interaction happens when T cells?
So definitely this pattern you see in vivo. In fact, that's why people were so gung-ho about this pattern, because when you take an influence from a mouse and you stain the cell, this is going to be the readout. You really see the T cells making a suction cup against the dendritic cell, that's really the readout that you can have for activation. At that time, if you didn't have any other readout. Now we can do a bit better, but at that time, that was the best readout that we could have. Yes.
Can you do in ecosystems where you spot epitopes on glass and then turf from below?
Absolutely. That's it. Because the best confirmation of this thing, you can do dust in there.
So that gets been replicated in vitro.
Yes, absolutely. So you can put these molecules, and people have done microfluidics to be able to make, to control the different height where you...
But if you have a cell that's going onto a glass surface coated with ICAM, ICAM's not mobile on that surface, so you only have the fusion on one side, so how do you...
I think many people lay out by layer, just you have to leave some motion, right? If it's not moving, in fact, no, there is one paper where they did some surface chemistry where they pre-sort the molecule based on this pattern, they tried to measure activation, and that's the way they tested it. So, you are from Berkeley, you should know about that, right? Yeah, from Berkeley? Okay. So that's a group from Berkeley, we did growth, we did a lot of bulk chemistry to be able to...
I'm a mechanical engineer, so I don't know.
So you should like that, there is some mechanics, right? I'm going to move away from mechanics and I'm going to do some ugly scenario. Right, so again, like any modern immunology, some good things to be able to go back to experiments and do, maybe some shortcomings. My biggest beef on the model, it doesn't deal with a big quantity of self-ligands, and it takes too much time to make the decision. So we're going to try to solve that in the next 20 minutes. Reference to these papers at the chapter book I sent, and don't hesitate to contact me if you want to read more about that. Happening on the membrane, and we have to reschedule for the different diffusion, we have to be able to account for things happening on the membrane, but at the same time, we are going to forget all these special aspects because things are too fast. We don't have time to equilibrate the mechanism. So again, if we start with a TNT profiling scheme, you take a beta-MHC, you make it interact with the TCR, and you form a complex which is going to get phosphorylated. So if you go back to the structure of interactions, this TCR comes in fact with many associated chains which can get phosphorylated. There are like 20,000 that you can phosphorylate. As soon as you phosphorylate, there are some other kinase which comes in by. I don't want to flood you with the details, but suddenly as you start engaging this TCR, you're going to start phosphorylating this complex, recruiting some of the kinase, and maybe changing the biochemistry in the system so that you can make a decision. So practically at the formal level, you're going to phosphorylate once, you're going to phosphorylate twice, and we can stay there for in the meantime. And the idea again about the KT profiling is that if you measure the kill-off here, and if you debind from here, you're going to go back very quickly in such a way that you're going to read this kill-off in this particular case three times. So if you are comparing the number of the doubly phosphorylated complex that you form between the non-self and the self as a readout for activation. What I told you yesterday that this was the ratio of the off rate. the shorter the lifetime, the better informed the complaint, to the number of TD-propane steps. In this case, we're going to stick to four, right? So you would predict that, you know, this kind of biochemistry where you're distinguishing between maybe a factor of 10x, and you're trying to make a distribution which gives you this kind of 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6x in terms of discrimination power, this is not going to be enough. And not only that, it takes so much time because it depends on the KT time scale that you have here, you're not going to be able to achieve the fast resolution at the end. So we have this kind of, you know, mad machine where we wanted to understand how we can reconcile all these numbers. And you know, there are some biochemistry, you know, happening at the same time. And there are many observations why, you know, other stuff must be happening. But the idea is that instead of having a single time scale for profiling, which is a classical upfield video idea where you bind your tRNA in the case of profiling video, and you're going to be able to wait a lifetime before doing the next step, and this is fixed. What we're going to do is that we're going to introduce some feedback in such a way that we're going to modulate the speed at which these things are being done. So the idea is that, biochemically, that what you're going to do is that you're going to activate the phosphatase. It's called SHIP1. I'm sorry for the name that we needed at the later stages. And the idea is that as this phosphatase gets activated, it's going to come back and it's going to be able to dephosphorylate, it's going to accelerate the dephosphorylation of this step. So it's really going to act as negative feedback. Right. So this was observed, but you know, again, as soon as you engage the TCR, you kind of activate this phosphatase, and we knew from some other work that this phosphatase potentially dephosphorylate and change the activity of the kinase, pushing the system in that direction. So classical idea of a negative feedback, if you are loading the system with a huge quantity of bad ligands, you're going to form a complex, maybe you're going to go here once in a while, you're going to activate a lot of this phosphatase. Once you have a huge quantity of negative feedback, you're going to push the system towards going to staying at 1-0, right? So the idea is that, again, you're going to use this phosphatase to modulate the speed at which you go to the right and the speed at which you go to the left. And instead of having a fixed time scale at which you're going to be able to move through the different states, you're going to make it harder and harder as you're activating the cell because you're loading more and more phosphatase into the system. So you can sense already that things get a bit more dynamic. Things are going to get a little bit more stretchable in the way it works in the phase space of parameters. So practically, if you look again at the number of doubly phosphorylated molecules that you form the system as a function of number of peptide MHC, we have a simple scaling happening, right? Depending on the number of TD-propane steps, this might be different scaling, so this could be a different propelling scheme. And the idea is that as you add this negative feedback in this phosphatase, especially when you have a huge quantity of peptide energy, huge activation of phosphatase, huge quantity of negative feedback, potentially what you're going to do is that you're going to start to make something which really starts to saturate very quickly. Right? So why is that useful? Well, it's useful because now if you do the same with so that would be for non-self good ligands which tends to bind with a longer lifetime. You do the same measurements now with self, something which binds a bit weaker. Because it binds a bit weaker, you can move. You just shift your scaling to the right because it takes more peptide energy to achieve the same level of phosphorylation. But now when you add the negative feedback, you're going to completely saturate. And this scales, I didn't put what it does, but if it's a threshold of activation that you need to be able to drive activation downstream, you see that suddenly, thanks to negative feedback, you're never going to be able to pass the threshold and you're never going to be able to get any kind of activation. While at the same time, you are going to be able, you didn't change that much where this point is on the curve because you're not going to be able to, you're not activating much negative feedback at low dose of peptide-MHC. So if you just wire that up, and originally when I did that work during my postdoc, it was a very ugly big model with a lot of biochemistry. Massimo and Paul and Eric really see this problem and made it in a very nice much more understand what we're saying, but the gist of the matter is like that. Again, you rely on the negative feedback to be able to block the activation of a large quantity of non-self ligands, of self ligands. Right? Again, a big quantity of ligands which bind very poorly, activate a huge quantity of phosphatase, and this slows down dramatically your ability to phosphorylate the system. It really makes it harder and harder to reach the end state. But at the same time, you don't want to block all the activation from the non-self. What you see is that at low dose, at low number of non-self ligands, where you want the cells to get activated, you are not activating much phosphatase, so you are not influencing much this pathway, and you're going to be able to get this kind of very sharp discrimination. So again, this particularly can be a single peptide energy, and this can be moved away larger than 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6, you never pass the threshold when you have the cell thesis. Right? Question?
Sort of a more general question, but if the fastest that this process takes place would be 1 minute, and you have a single infected cell, that could conceivably take, you know, your entire lifetime to detect that.
Right, it does not. You're right, but
statistically, or is it though, because it's done in parallel?
You're really friendlying these cells one at a time.
But you have multiple cells that may be infected.
First, most of the time you have multiple cells infecting. Second, you don't. When I say that for a given specificity you have only 10 to 100 clones, that's for a given TCR. But there are many different TCR which can recognize the same antigens. So practically, you can do this experiment. You inject a peptide at very low dose, and maybe not 1 minute, maybe 5 minutes. But this is really the time scale at which you have to multiply by the number of different clones which can recognize the same antigens. And there's a lot of degeneracy, so it's worth it. No, that's a good point. Right, so, and okay, you could say, well, if you wait long enough, and you're going to still keep accumulating with phosphatase, maybe it's going to start spoiling you. So there's kind of a fail-safe system, which you don't really need on a short time scale to build this stable, but which is very important downstream. If you activate the system, what it means practically that you're going to activate a pathway called MAP kinase. And what this MAP kinase does is it's going to switch off the negative feedback. So it's going to block the ability of this phosphatase to act on the system. So again, what you have is kind of a time race, right? You start loading your MHC onto the TCR. You are still starting moving down this chain and starting phosphorylating. That goes slower and slower because you're getting more and more phosphatase activated. But if you do manage to accumulate enough of this endpoint here, you activate this other pathway. This pathway comes and shuts down the negative feedback. Okay? Question? Okay. So, the idea that you are kind of reading this scale dynamically is very much true. But instead of thinking of it as a simple principle threading with a very flat phase space of parameter and a very hard time to account for that, what you see is that things are much more dynamic, right? You have a break that you're activating very upstream, and something which is going to be a fair set of systems to enable you to maintain your signaling on longer time scales. So this kind of is a very nice trick. In fact, it's one of the one trick pony that we use in the lab all the time. Every time you want to expand the dynamic range of your system, every time you want a system which is a bit more accurate in the way it makes decisions, you might rely on some phosphatase as a negative feedback, right, to block the noise from the system. And then you use a positive feedback downstream to really be able to maintain and commit yourself towards activation. So this is a bit, maybe it's kind of trivial for physicists, but bioterminology didn't like that at all, because instead of thinking of self-non-self as a kind of marble table or something very set in stone where you look at your ligand, you should be able to say where it's self and non-self, you see that self-non-self completely depends on this feedback. Right? It's a dynamic definition based on your ability to activate the phosphatase the kinase downstream. So in particular, it's very possible that this threshold is completely tunable. Depending on the level of phosphatase that you have, you might be able to shift and adjust the way this table is being set. And that's what I'm going to walk you through in the last minutes of this lecture. There are some predictions, there are some observations that I didn't give you up front because I didn't want to explode your brain. But there are a lot of observations that we can deal with this model, which makes it kind of very tantalizing and very, very promising. Something I already mentioned, which is antagonism. So So that's the idea that if you take something in the gray boundary, right, something which is maybe between self and non-self, maybe something which is at 3 seconds, in terms of life, not only this guy is not going to be able to activate the system, it tends to have a negative effect on the cinnamon cascade. So again, if what you see experimentally is that if you load, let's say, you take a certain number of abilities of a non-self, let's say, 10 ligands, by itself, if you look at activation, so you can measure it again at very short time scale, but if you look at the activation, it should be very high by itself. But now, if you titrate with antagonist ligand, what you see is that because you are loading the system with a lot of fully activating peptide C, they're going to drive the activation of a lot of phosphatase, and you're going to load the bases with a lot of phosphatase, right? So ultimately, if you're trying to push a signal through this cascade, that there is another pathway which activates a lot of this phosphatase, it's going to completely block your ability to go down this line. So what you see is that you're going to be able to completely block the activation of your agonist by titrating your antagonist. So not only that, but when you do, right, so it's kind of nice because, you know, and we could test it experimentally, that's really associated with this phosphatase, meaning that when we take a lot of antagonists, they are really acting as a spoiler because they are activating a lot of this phosphatase, and this comes back to bite the non-self activation. So again, this is not something that we wired up in the model originally, that's really, you know, a consequence of this phosphatase device, and we can really check quantitatively that indeed, depending on the lifetime of the antagonist, typically maybe something on the order of 3 seconds, they're going to be able to titrate and take down the agonist, the non-self ligand, and take down the activation. So this is a kind of maybe a neat trick in the system which enables us to sort out different models. So we can account for that in the dynamic model. But it's also useful biologically, right? When you look at a real infection, let's say you take HIV infecting a T cell, right? Very quickly it's gonna get, it's gonna be processed the same way that the cell does, and you're gonna get some peptide associated with HIV which is going to be present. And hopefully another T cell, which might be a different type but which is gonna be sensitive, can come to recognize that and then kill it. Right? So you come in that system and you look at the sequence of this peptide, so let's say something derived from a particular protein. You're going to get a certain sequence which I don't remember, like 8 to 10 amino acids. And again, this is non-self for the system. So the trigger is the cell, they're going to try to kill, they're going to start to proliferate, and you should be good, right? You're able to recognize HIV when they infect T cells, you're able to, you have a big pool of T cells which are going to go recognize this peptide, you should be able to clear the infection very quickly. But of course, HIV is very fast at mutating, as I think Boris when I mentioned a lot of work on that. So very quickly, you're going to start to mutate this peptide. So practically, numerically, if this was a non-self with a lifetime in terms of peptide HTCR interaction on the order of 10 seconds, as soon as you start making a mutation, there is a very high probability that you're going to degrade the interaction between the peptide HTCR and the TCR, and then quickly this off-rate is going to shrink to something which is maybe on the order of 3 seconds. You see that you're going to switch from something which looks like non-self, which is very good at activating the cell even at a low dose, into something which looks like it was very nasty in a way. It's particularly relevant in the case of HIV, that not only you're going to build something which is no longer recognized by this T cell, but this is really going to act as an antagonist, and it's really going to block the proliferation of the T cells. So this is really a dynamic process, and we care about this antagonism because it's really a way for a virus to escape recognition. Not only is it going to escape by not being able to activate the system by itself, it's going to also escape by being able to take down whatever immune response you are trying to build against the original epitope, against the original antigen that you have in the system. So something extremely important to understand quantitatively, because we want to anticipate this mutation, and maybe we want to select a clone which is going to be very robust and immune to this type of perturbation to avoid the ability to escape.
Right.
And you could think that, for example, this idea of antagonism could be a good idea if you want to try to block autoimmune disorder, right? And when you look at diabetes or multiple sclerosis or all kind of autoimmune disorders based on T cells, most of the time what you have is that something which is supposed to be non-self is actually your T cells giving you some hyperactivation. Mm-hmm. We could build a specific antagonist, maybe we could take down the activation of these T cells and be able to really, you know, redirect the response. This was a very promising idea, but the clinical trial was completely failing, because if you are designing an antagonist for a particular TCR, this might very well be an antagonist for another TCR. So you're not, you can take down whatever T cells you are activating inside these diabetic models, but very quickly you're going to activate another set of T cells, you're going to get another set of autoimmune models, so this has not been very efficient. Right. So this was one prediction that we can validate. Again, the idea is that if you look at the function of the 1 over KR, which is again the lifetime of a cryptanalytic cell, if you look at the number of ligands that you need to activate, and what I mean by activation again is some kind of a signaling cascade happening very upstream on the timescale of maybe 1 to 5 years. What you get is something which is very nonlinear, right? And everything above 10 seconds practically can activate the cell with the single ligands. And because of this feedback, because of this phosphatase and this positive feedback image kinase, you're going to get a very huge divergence very quickly, in such a way that as you do a mutation, you move below 1 second, the threshold of activation completely diverge, and the cells are not going to be able to be activated at all. And you get this gray zone in between, where maybe if you have enough ligands, like an antagonist at 3 seconds, if you have enough of them, they might start to activate the system on their own. But more importantly, all these things in these gaps can be very good at blocking the activation of the agonist, because they're activating a lot of phosphatase. So earlier, you had this question about what this gap about. In a way, we describe it as a kind of a band gap, right? You go into a regime where you activate, you make the cell into a very refractory mode when you're activating these things, and that's the way you're going to be able to really discriminate in 1 second, in 10 seconds, because you're building this huge nonlinearity with the parameters. It's particularly important because it predicts that as you take rate, as you test different ligands, so you can take, let's say, a particular antigen, and you mutate, and if you're lucky, you're going to mutate exactly into that zone, and what you see is that the closer you are to being an agonist, the more phosphatase you're going to be able to activate, the better an antagonism you are. So we're predicting a way that before it gets better, it gets really bad, right? And if you get the activation of the phosphatase, you're going to get into very refractory mode, and then it becomes irrelevant, maybe because of the map kinase. So again, the prediction from the model is that as you titrate, as you test different ligands with different lifetime, you see that the closer you are to the transition, the more of an antagonist you are, and you can test that experimentally in the first. Okay.
Yes.
What did I want to tell you? Okay. Another very nice idea associated with that, and something I kind of kept under the carpet a little bit as we went along, is that one very important aspect of clonal selection theory, one very important aspect of T cells, that you are removing self-responsive programs, right? As you generate a repertoire of T cells with a lot of mutations, you want to be able to wean out all the clones which are self-responsive. The way it's done is that what you do is that you take the T cells and you are kind of going to make them, you are going to educate them. So we heard a little bit about that from Thomas yesterday. That's something which happens in the thymus. By the selection of the cells. And again, in the context of clonal selection theory, this is a very critical mechanism to be able to remove all the self-responsive T cells. So what does it have to do with that? Well,
as soon as people started to clone the TCR, they noticed that when you look at the peptides inside your thymus, they tend to be antagonists. They tend to be ligands which are recognized by the T cells in periphery, but they are below threshold, which is good, right? You don't want self-peptides to be able to activate. But in a sense, what they show is they are not like any self-peptide. They tend to be the better peptides which are kind of close to the threshold of activation. So again, the idea is that you start from the bone marrow, the bone, I guess, the T cells come out as progenitors, as white T cells. They move to the thymus. There, inside the thymus, they're going to be presented with a self repertoire. And again, if you don't have any response to the self repertoire, you're going to be selected. And you go to the periphery, right? You're going to leave. But if you do respond to the self repertoire, then you're going to be taken out by apoptosis and you die. So, that means that these T cells, at some point, were tested against the self repertoire. And the very cool idea associated with this scheme is that this is competitionable. You can competition the way this threshold is being set. So again, in the phase space of parameters, if I make the relationship between the beta NHC TCR interaction and the capacity to activate the T cells, you get this very sharp phase space in the way, facilitated that way, where you can get activated with very few ligands when you have a lifetime which is maybe about 10 seconds in the periphery, and as soon as you move out of that, the threshold of activation diverges, you don't get anything. But the idea is that if you start to play around with this in the model with different level of phosphatase, this threshold becomes conditionable. Okay. So this is very important because in fact, I'm kind of lying to you by saying that there is only negative selection happening. You also need to test whether the cells can recognize the self. So there is one part which is going to be positive selection where you want to respond to cells. And if you do respond, you continue. If you don't, you die. Same thing for this guy. If you cannot respond to self, you continue. And then maybe if you respond too much, you die. And if you don't, you're going to die. This positive selection is very important. You have to remember that these T cells have been made by somatic mutation, right? You are taking your receptors, you are putting some mutation inside the receptors in a very random manner. It's very easy to think you make a very crappy T cell, something which never responds to anything. So what the thymus is doing is that it's really going to first select those T cells which are able to respond to the cell, right? You're not just going to make a bunch of crappy T cells that never get activated because their TCR don't fold properly because of mutations. First thing you're going to do is you're going to check that you can connect with the rest of the signaling machinery. And this you're going to do with what you have, which is a self repertoire. And this we see experimentally. You take T cells inside the thymus. Inside the thymus, they are responding to the self repertoire. And as they move along and they start to differentiate towards moving to the periphery, they lose their ability to see the self repertoire. Right? So in terms of education, it's the best, right? You're going to be exposed to the self-repertoire, at a different repertoire from you, right? All our T cells are different. But what you're going to do, you're going to say, if you want to be a good T cell, you have to be able to see the self-repertoire, and then lose the ability to see the self-repertoire when you move to the periphery. And the idea is that you can do it by really playing on the level of this phosphatase. You can tune your signal machinery in such a way that you start with a very low level of phosphatase, you start with a very dull T cell, which only does the thinking for playing. In a sense, it's going to be very crappy, maybe with something which is extremely shallow in the response. So if you are able to respond to the self-repertoire, you're going to get some activation if there is enough of them. But as you move along, this axis, which corresponds to time, which corresponds to differentiation, also corresponds to upregulation of chip 1. Right? So you are starting to load up more and more of this chip 1 phosphatase. That start to sharpen up the phase space of parameters and start to move this transition towards the right to make more and more spectrum. And you're going to stop exactly at the right place. If your self-repertoire has a distribution of lifetime which is like that, you're going to move, you're going to upregulate the shift one in such a way that you're going to lose all the response to be self-antigen, right? You're going to set the threshold exactly there. And why is it a very nice process? It means that this level of phosphatase is going to be tuned exactly at the right place. We could say, well, you start here,
equilibrium phosphatase to give you a threshold here, and then you upregulate it by a factor of 100, and then you end up with your threshold, which is here, right? If you do it in a completely non-dynamic manner, you will completely move from something which responds to self to something which doesn't respond to self. The problem with this idea is that you lose the capacity to respond to all these ligands. So if a bug comes in with a ligand in that region of the phase space of parameters, you just never respond to it. The idea of fine-tuning the level of phosphatase in such a way that you are just going to be at the cusp between being able to respond to the self and not being able to respond to the self, it means that anything above the self, and I mean really mean anything, is going to be able to trigger a T cell. So this is really the idea that you can use this knob, you can use this kind of a break in a very tunable manner to really adapt the way you respond to self and yourself. This is being done in the thymus, and we could check that experimentally, quantitatively. As you move the level of SHIP1, it's not that quantitative, it's kind of qualitative, but you see that as you move from very naive progenitors in the thymus, you move towards more and more differentiation, you load the sample, the system with more and more SHIP1, and when we go from mouse to mouse, from different network of ourselves, we see that the level of SHIP1 is really being activated, being upregulated and adjusted for each different mouse in a very different manner, for each different TCR in a very different manner. So this is really kind of fine-tuned in such a way that you are going to be able to block the self-repertoire and just the self-repertoire. Right? Anything above that is going to give you activation. So it's kind of the best of two worlds, right? You're going to build a system which is very responsive, with a very high sensitivity because you are not activating the negative feedback. But the negative feedback is going to be exactly finely tuned to crank out anything coming from the self-repertoire. Okay? Is it clear or am I moving too fast or? Okay? So, 15 more minutes, right? What?
It's time.
Alright, so I'm just going to throw a quick wrench. I'm going to mess up this model very quickly. So, it's, right? I mean, like, beginning of the beginning of millennium, people thought that we deal with robustness and we could wire up anything we want in the system. What I'm telling you is exactly you're going to robustness in a sense. I have this monster negative feedback in the system which really controls the transition between self and non-self. If I mess up to this level, most likely I'm going to be able to mess up with the self. So just to conclude this thing, try to walk you through a very dynamic model which enables you to account for self and non-self. I rely on negative feedback to be able to build this very sharp dynamic system which makes the discrimination. The weak point of this idea, in fact something we check experimentally, is that within the population of T cells, there's so much variability in the level of the phosphatase that you're going to mess up the system in a dramatic manner. As soon as you have one clone expressing a bit too much SHIP1, most likely it's going to be completely hyper-responsive. As soon as you have cells expressing too little SHIP1, they're going to be hyper-responsive. So if we look, if we do a single cell measurement, you are going to see that the distribution of SHIP1 is abnormal with a spread of CV on the order of 0.5. And what that means, if I look at those cells, you have a very high level of SHIP1. Whatever you do, you are never going to be able to activate them. And if you look at this cell which has a low level of SHIP1, low level of negative feedback, and it's very easy to activate them very strongly. So you're, instead of dealing with these cells which are homogeneous, we have a problem of noise, which is that there is some variability in the system at key components, and this translates into some phenotypic variability, meaning that so phenotypic variability, even if I think that these cells are very godly and they are very good at discriminating and can make this very sharp discrimination, there is going to be always some noise in the system, and this I'm going to try to solve in the next lectures by looking at all the time. Thank you.
We're really short of time. If there's one quick question, we'll take it. Otherwise, I encourage you to talk to the
lawyer. I have to mention that I'm not going to give you some very hard math in the exercise session. Okay. It would be more like an open session where you can ask questions and cool. I will challenge you.
So we'll start again at 11:20 sharp. Okay.